We will now be moving on to our next panel, which is again going to be very interesting. We'll be talking about participatory philanthropy. So it's my pleasure to actually welcome two of India's most leading philanthropists, philanthropist couple, if I may say so. And let me have the pleasure of welcoming our moderator for the sort of discussion today, Ms. Pritha Venkatachalam, a partner at the Britspan Group for India. Pritha, over to you for the kickoff.
Thank you, Sriram, and a very good afternoon to all of you who are zooming in from India. Usually the post-lunch session is the most notorious slot, but I'm not worried at all given the four engaging co-panelists I have who, with just their energy and what they've done so far, I'm sure are going to keep you all more than just awake. And for those of you who are dialing in from rest of the world, I hope you're not zombied out already with the 24-hour edition, and that you're awake and listening for what I hope would be some strong insights that we all hope to glean from this session on participative philanthropy. I'm not going to take too much of sound bites, given we have four illustrious philanthropists, philanthropic couples, as Sriram put it, who are very well known, not just to be impact-oriented, but also really thoughtful and humane in their approach to philanthropy. So rather than go by their bio of introduction, let me just say one thing that I find inspiring about these two couples. And then, of course, the floor is theirs to, you know, tell us about their philanthropic journey. Amit and Archana have done a lot in terms of not just rural transformation, but what I find particularly inspiring is their contribution to build the NGO sector itself overall, when most people were still figuring out how programmatic impact can make a difference to India's SDGs. I think Amit and Archana took their program support to another level to also support building a strong and resilient nonprofit sector through their capacity building work. And Archana, of course, has an additional hat she wears, which is probably the bigger hat on leading Jai Vakil for intellectually disabled. And we hope we'll also hear some of her wisdom from that second large hat she wears. Ronnie and Zarina, of course, are again very well known for their work in both rural India as well as education technology. Well before the pandemic hit, they were well into reverse migration, and not just migration with livelihoods, but migration back to villages with pride and dignity, which to me is really inspiring in their approach towards empowerment, because it's not about just getting the people back to their villages, calling them migrants, as opposed to actually giving them the lives that they can be proud of. The second thing, of course, again, they were well ahead of their time in terms of looking at how higher education can be enabled by technology. And all of what they are doing now is absolutely relevant and in face of how India and the world is reacting to the pandemic. So we'd be delighted to welcome both of you couples to the panel, and looking forward to hear your insights. One final framing point from me before I hand it over. I know as we were gearing up for this session, I received several emails and WhatsApp messages asking, what do you all actually mean by participative philanthropy? A lot of people have heard about participatory governance, you know, where it is governance through the people. And if we were to extend that logic and apply it and adapt it for philanthropy, essentially there are two constructs to what is participative philanthropy. The first construct being that you're moving beyond just cutting a check or looking at it as pure charity to listening deeply, not just to the nonprofits you work with, but also the communities that you're working to empower and work with, and giving them a voice and working with their needs bottom up through your philanthropic approaches. So that's one paradigm where the communities are enabled, empowered, and owners of their own development narrative. And the second construct of philanthropy, being participative on a lighter vein, given both of you couples work together so closely, hopefully both in your home domain and work domains, we'd love to hear more about the yin and yang of how you bring it all together. But jokes apart, the participatory approach of how you also work beyond just with each other, but with the broader stakeholders, government, other philanthropies, etc., is I think the second dimension of participative or collaborative philanthropy we'd love to hear about. So with those opening remarks, I'll probably start with Ronnie and Zarina, if that's okay. And I'd love to hear from both of you about how your philanthropic journey or evolution has really spoken to being participative, and what you have learned and what you can share about your journey and the stories that you've enabled in rural and urban India.
Sorry, I thought the host was going to unmute us, but that's fine. We just did that. So thank you and welcome everyone else. Hi. I think our journey started pretty young. And I think that's something that I both of us are very proud of, because I think it's a strong message for even everyone here, where everyone first assumes that you need to have in order to give back, or you need to be a little bit more older in life and therefore relatively have freer time, which is a misnomer by itself. Actually, it gets even more crowded when you get to that level. So I think it started at a very early stage when we kind of decided that, you know, 10% of everything that would be there in life or what we were doing with our organizations, we would want to give back. It was a seed, but that seed grew into something. The first step I think we took was more where if there was a 10,000 square foot office, and I'm giving that symbolically so that everyone realizes that it's not about, again, as you mentioned, cutting a check, that 1,000 square feet of that was allocated to a old age home and a creche. The company and every single staff member there kind of owned it as much as we did. Then cut to a lot later on, one of our first employees took us to rural Maharashtra in the Raigad district. And that's when we got it connected with the rural part. Cut to many, many years later when we divested our company and for the first time felt that we were not in debt, but we had some assets and a bank balance in which we could do something. And that's when Zarina and I discussed what do we really want to do to scale up the foundation. And I'll let her take it from there.
Oh, really? Okay, fine. So basically, we were both still working with our company UTV, even though we had divested. But I think my heart was a little bit broken, and I, you know, it was like my baby had gone, which was UTV, and I was actually looking around for work because I said I can't do UTV anymore. And then I remember me telling Ronnie, I think I want to join a particular organization whom I have deep respect for. And he said, and later he always tells me it was a retention strategy line. So I'll tell you what the line was. And it was deeply inspiring, and it still inspires me today, which is, let's lift a million people out of poverty every 5 years. So I thought that was completely crazy, completely challenging, completely would take my entire being to kind of figure out how on earth we were going to do something like that. And especially because we were media people. I mean, what on earth did we know about poverty? Nothing. I think the good thing about us is that we know when we don't know. We knew we didn't know anything about poverty. So for the first year, this was 2012. So for one full year, we did nothing. We had a team. The entire team and Ronnie and me went all over India. And in fact, we finally landed up in Bangladesh with BRAC. And that was deeply inspiring. Finally, that is what inspired us. We did a whole study of a year. I'm talking about traveling almost every month to 2-3 places, meeting people. It was just the only thing we did. And finally, we came up with a kind of model, with a kind of decision. And the decisions at that time sounded really crazy because people were not doing this. And all our well-wishers, everyone we spoke to when we finally came out of that 1 year of study were aghast at what I'm about to say. Today, of course, it sounds, yeah, okay, fine. The first one was 360-degree development model, which means whatever it takes, actually. And in our minds, what it takes is, and we're talking about rural India because we were very attached to rural India. And as Ronnie said, we'd been already working there for about 16, 17 years. So we had a good depth of knowledge. We had the trust of the community. So we decided water, sanitation, and in sanitation, again, individual household toilet, which is again, not the norm at the time. Health, education, and the crowning glory of livelihood. So if you can think of it as a little pie, you know? So that is the first thing. And the second thing is that we were going to be collaborative, which is the word that you also used, Preeta. We were not going to reinvent the wheel. I think one thing that media taught us, and actually there were several lessons from media, is that be collaborative. It's like you don't want to produce a film, direct a film, write a film, and act in a film, right? You want to get the best director, the best producer, the best writer, the best actors, and create your film. Yes. So that's one. The other learning is have deep respect, and perhaps even the right word for me personally is love your audience, your community. Understand your community. And now we come to your participative part. If I met you, you would have a card that I would hand to you. And on the top of it, it would be written, Swar se bane des, which means I make my country, I make it, I make my life, I am in charge. And that is the ethos with which we worked. And we've had a lot of lessons. Let me be honest, it wasn't easy. This whole business of rural empowerment, the whole idea that poverty, our realization as we worked, was that poverty was not about eliminating material deficiencies. Poverty is about changing mindsets. Poverty is in the mind. It's in the heart. It's in the belief that I have no hope. I can do nothing. I cannot change anything. And this working with mental and material poverty is something that we've mastered now. And we've created 1,000 villages who are completely, I mean, obviously in varying degrees, but they are really empowered through what we call the village development committees. And Preeta, even in COVID time, we managed to work with all 1,000 of our villages through these village development committees. Thousands of grafting of plantation, lots of distribution of food and groceries through these villages. So work did not stop with COVID, thanks to these empowered rural communities. And so that's, I think I can stop there for now. I think I've said enough. Yeah. So I think that's been our journey.
Thanks. No, I think that was really powerful, not just what you learned from media. And I really loved your mention of how to produce something world-class. You need to take the best of everyone and everything, including the communities that you respect and love, as you put it. On that note, moving on to Amit and Archana, we'd love to hear how participative philanthropy has influenced your work, not just in terms of your approach, but also your impact. Amit, I know you speak widely about a high return on investment for impact. So we'd love to hear about how participative philanthropy might have shaped that.
Thank you so much, first of all, to Nudge for inviting both of us to be here today. And it's really a pleasure to share the same forum with our good friends, Zarina and Ronnie. You know, for us, participative philanthropy does mean one more thing as well, which is going to the root cause of eliminating a problem as opposed to just solving the symptoms of it. So I just wanted to introduce that dimension as well. You know, for many years, I mean, like Ronnie and Zarina, we started our journey relatively early. When we got married, I remember as paying guests, we didn't have much money, disposable income to spend, but we started, seeding scholarships right way back then, and then gradually increasing whatever share of our disposable income we could on projects that we cared about. Education was the first big area that we really focused on. I was very affiliated with Akanksha. Archana joined Akanksha as well. And education was the first major vertical that we really worked on. But over time, I think there was a realization that we had that that a couple of things really mattered. One is that the scale of our problems in the country were really huge, that we couldn't really just spend our way out of it by treating the symptoms. We really needed to go to the root cause and address them. Second is that while we were focusing on education, more and more we got drawn into rural India, and we were focusing more on urban issues. It was actually a conversation that Archana tabled when we were analyzing where we were spending our money, that we realized we were focusing more on urban issues than rural issues, and we started getting drawn more to rural India. And we realized that until we actually start fixing rural issues as opposed to urban issues, and that's what got us to focus on agri-stress. It's a combination of, root cause, agri-stress, that got us interested more in participative philanthropy. And we realized that we, like Zarina said, we knew very little about the problem. And therein we realized that we needed to actually listen to the community very deeply in order to devise solutions. Sitting in our offices in Mumbai, we would actually fall flat on our face if we really had to, be successful. And so it's been a long journey for us. If we really want to have a great impact, we've realized we've had to, bring a lot of humility to the table, make sure that everything we do has a lot of community input into it. We've had to work extensively with partners on the ground to scale up our solutions. That's, I come to things with an enormous data bias. In order to ensure that there's a high social ROI to everything that we do, we've had to bring that sense of community to build scale. We've had to build a lot of collaborations, and that's how we've actually traversed this journey. Archana, if you'd like to add anything to that.
Yeah, so I think Zarina and Amit and Ronnie before me have really articulated very well the fact that, we've come to this space with a very clear and strong desire to do something, but less knowledge. And I think that same lens is what I used for my work at Jaivakil, Pritha. So, Jaivakil, like you rightly mentioned, works with the intellectually challenged. And I thought very early on that since I'm not trained to really work with children in the classroom, it's very important for us as an organization to actually ensure that the voices of the beneficiary are kind of embedded deeply into the interventions that we do. So let me give you an example of this as recently as the COVID situation that we're all going through, right? So I think in March, very early on, Pritha, when we were touching base with our staff and our kids and their parents, we were asking them, are you safe? Is all okay? What is it that you need? And they were the ones saying that, since 40% of our students are from the lower socioeconomic strata, the immediate need was food on the table and medicines for the kids, because it's neurology drugs, we can't have them being stopped, etc. As the months and weeks grew, when we were then checking in with the parents, they were saying, it's very difficult to keep these children at home all day. Earlier wo school mein jaate the, to unko thodi outing hoti thi, hum bhi apna kaam kar lete. So can you help us create some sort of a timetable or a structure for our children at home? Right, and this is something that the parents articulated to us in April. So we went back with that need to the teachers. And our teachers also, they were all over the place. Some of them were in their villages. So we said, the only thing that we can do right now is use technology. So there was this whole conversation around how will the parents use it, because there is this whole digital divide. Teachers were also, in far-flung remote areas, little or no access to Wi-Fi. But I think the magic was, again, we want to do this. And then, the why was so resounding and important for us that then the how became, we'll figure it out, right? And then, of course, with a lot of training and a lot of help, in 3 weeks, our teachers turned out over 150 videos that the parents could use in their houses across 13 domains. So ranging from like activities of daily living, a little bit of academic curriculum, sports, music, dance, art, some of the things that the parents could do together as a family. All of this came together, in the form of our digital content library within a month, right? And initially it was done for our children. So, the need, the whole lens was familiar voice, familiar content, and familiar face. But then we realized that, other children from other schools were also using this. So within, I think a couple of months, 2 or 3 months now, we have over 1 lakh views. When we looked at data and circled back with the parents and said, online education has begun, are these videos still useful? We found that 47% of our parents said that they were still using at least one video a day. Right? And this was done again in a very partnership model, because our teachers made the videos. We also reached out to a lot of our partners. So music, Shyamak has done the dance videos, Priyanka Pandit has done the music videos, Kamakshi has done videos for music. So the whole library that has come together has been very, very collaborative as well, right? And the way I see it is, you know, we also took our curriculum all over Maharashtra in July this year. So this whole digital content library is now also being used by kids all across Maharashtra. So the point I'm making here is that by embedding the voices of our beneficiaries, we build something. Now we're continuously going back to them to see what is the future of something like this look like. Today it is, you know, all of Maharashtra and the Jai Vakil kids, but using the digital platform, it can easily be the whole country tomorrow.
Yeah, it's a beautiful idea. Beautiful.
Yeah. That's amazing. So I think what I hear from both Amit and Archana is also reflecting what Ronnie and Zarina started with, which is, you know, clearly both the couples are so much embedded in a learning and humility approach as you look to serve communities, which to me is a very essential part of being participative. It cannot be a top down, I know the solution, please come and buy the solution that I'm providing. And I think that core really came out very well in all the experience that you all narrated. I think on the theme of built to last that Archana, you know, left this conversation with, Aishi built this video library that hopefully can last well beyond the pandemic. I'm also looking at the chat box and going to weave in some of the questions from the very lively audience. And I think a question on the built to last, Ronnie and Zarina, for you all that's coming up is, how do you think the Raigad model can really inform rural empowerment broader in India, in terms of community empowerment, community development?
I think built to last, all of us, I mean, I think the participative context, the very first focus is outcomes. And I think that's a focus that all of us look at. So built to last is a very relevant part of it, because I think what we want to do is transfer. And as soon as the community gets control of their own destiny, that's when the built to last happens. In a BOT model in the corporate world is you pass it on. This pass on is really when they control their own destiny. And I think that's our single objective. I think the second one of how that transcends, I think it's twofold. One is we needed to create a model at scale, because you can create dream villages or X villages in 10 or 15 villages. But when you do that at a scale of 2000 and 2200 villages, then you create a model. How do you document it and how do you take it forward is one element. And I think that's something we want to definitely transpose and migrate in a large manner. So we spent a fair amount of time on actually documenting all the lessons there too. But at the core of it, I think it is when you can pass the baton and when that community is in control of their own destiny, which is primarily a combination of your own livelihood, that's the real time when built to last happens.
Yeah, and also I think one of the core objectives of Swadesh is the need to exit. It's every 5 years. We have not achieved this, I need to say, and it's been 7 years. But now I think the model that we are creating, and our aim is to create a model for others to follow, has an exit strategy built into it. So before we go into something, we try to figure out who will this be? And always the answer is the community. So how can we empower the community to take this over? How can we link them to government schemes? How can we link them to corporates? How can we link them to markets? Basically, we're here to create an ecosystem. This is our exit strategy, where the community is able to completely tell us, okay, please come and see us once a year. Now we can stand on our own 2 feet. That's our goal.
Yeah, Zarina, just on that point, one additional question. You alluded in your first opening remarks to your village development committees, and we are also aware of the water committees. That's what the foundation has helped institute. So given this whole theme of participative philanthropy, also linking, as you said, to governance, right? That communities can own their destiny, as Ronnie just put it. Where do you see that linkages in your contribution to overall participatory growth and governance?
See, I think with, honestly, this it's a great word, participatory philanthropy. It's quite a mouthful also. Yeah. But I think without it, I don't think you should get into it. I just don't think it makes any sense. Then you're not doing philanthropy, you're doing charity. And we don't want to do charity. We want to empower people. So if you can't transfer, if you can't really work on the mental poverty that I spoke of earlier, which gives them that I can attitude. I'll give you an example. During the time of COVID, and we have 1,000 village development committees. So So we managed to reach out to each and every village development committee to see what they needed. What do you need right now? So 300 of them needed food right now, like today, tomorrow, day after, because they were migrant, meaning they were Adivasi community who worked daily wage earners, and they had to go back home, and there was no money at all. So we managed to get the food and the monthly rations, but how to distribute? So we had one, we had some very brave Swadesh volunteers, but the community, these village development committees who have 10 women, 5 women, 5 men, 2 youth, came out and helped us to distribute to the entire village, it's quite risky, but they did it. And that seva ka bhavna is also part of the exit strategy, that we can look after our own. For example, many village development committees, when these reverse migrants came, they formed community rules themselves, that these rural migrants who have come from Bombay, Pune, will have to stay in this particular place. They will have to self-isolate. They cannot move out. These families will cook for them. This is how we will organize it. They did all that. That entire organizational process for something as drastic as COVID was looked after by them. Not only that, in all 1,000 villages, they made a list of the poorest of the poor old people who could not go out of their home, could not go to the market. And they made a list and they went house to house, collected the needs, and the able people who were younger went to the market and then distributed it to the households. So you have stories like this. This is really sustainable. This sort of attitude is sustainable.
Great. And I think having a similar approach, Amit and Archana, you all have been, you know, almost COVID warriors, because you all have been supporting so much of the work in Mumbai through COVID at multiple dimensions, right? Like right from food distribution to slums, you know, some of the work with the healthcare systems, now the zero prevalence studies. So, you know, a lot of your work working with communities to support the COVID response. So would you mind sharing some of your, you know, lessons from there in the urban context?
Sure. Yeah, you know, I think, look, there are lots of lessons from COVID, and I think they apply equally to the urban and the rural context. I would say one is it's been a extremely humbling experience. You just realize you're fighting an unknown enemy, one you can't see, we have no experience dealing with. And sometimes you feel incredibly helpless, but yet you need to go out and fight it every day. I think you realize that the need for having deep collaborations. You need to collaborate, between the state and civil society. And in fact, I think a lot of the work that you referred to in Mumbai and across Maharashtra, we've seen has happened. People have really been able to pull through times basically because of a deeply collaborative approach. We were able to ensure that people don't die of hunger, essentially because people really came together during the worst of times. So I think deep collaborations really mattered. It's also because at the end of the day, empathy prevailed over hate. Our society often, we've seen how hate can really divide all of us. But in this this time, it was really empathy. The fact that there were so many hundreds of millions of people who cared about each other and helped each other, whether it was donating or really stepping out and reaching out to each other, which really helped. And I think that, and the example that Zarina also talked about things that happened in villages, I think you realize the power of empathy. And I think that was another learning. I do feel that in all of this, you also realize that there's a deep, deep need for long-term planning that should not be lost on us. I would make a big plug for participative philanthropy, which calls for understanding both what communities really need, but also calls for going to the root cause of problems and tackling them before they become really big and we need to spend a multiple treating their symptoms. If you think of COVID, it would have been much easier to address the problem we have on hand And in fact, we would not have this scale of a problem if over decades we would have systemically ensured that our urban slums would not have been the squalor that they are in today. We would have actually built far more toilets in slum areas. In fact, we would have spread out the city through better urban planning. And it's the same case, by the way, with the work I do in water, for example. We would not have agri stress if we would actually do a lot more work with the groundwater recharge. The work that Ronnie and Zarina do in Swadesh Foundation, if we actually work a lot more system at the systemic level on livelihoods, we would not have migration into urban slums and they would not be in the condition that they are in today. So you realize that by our communities don't want to be in the condition they're in. We need to go in and hear them carefully and address things at the root cause is what you learn from COVID. And we need to think much more deeper about those issues. The fact that in all of North India, people are actually breathing polluted air and losing 5 years at the medium of their life. We need to go and address the root cause of those problems rather than dealing with the symptoms of them. So I think COVID actually at a basic level teaches us a lot of things. And we need to step back and think about how we deal with them. But it also shows us we are capable of working with each other. We are capable of working with lots of empathy and that actually anger in itself is not that productive as an emotion.
Yeah. I think Amit, you captured... Sorry,
I'll make one more point. Actually, COVID also teaches us a couple of more things. And, we've been investing very systematically in both technology and research because you realize that if you really want to deal with problems like this, you need to have data and insight. And you mentioned the seroprevalence study. That's an example of that. Unless we have cutting edge data, insight, and we will not have the tools to deal with complicated problems. And so for whether it's the governments or large foundations, we must keep away some part of our budgets to generating cutting edge insights, which will only happen if we have data and we have the right kind of people who can analyze those data. And I think, that's why basically there's a race to develop vaccines right now. And vaccines cannot be developed in a short period of time. You have to do them over long periods of time. And so if you have to deal with pandemics, that's what some of the longer term approaches need to be. It's the same with other problems as well. If we have to deal with agri stress, we need vibrant agri universities. And that's the other thing COVID teaches us.
Great. Now, I think, Amit, you captured that in a nutshell, combining the ethos of empathy with evidence. And I think that combination is so critical to deal with not just a pandemic, but just even development paradigms in normal times. And as Ritzfan, we recently did a big study on looking at community engagement in slums of Mumbai. And we all know the Dharavi model has got a lot of attention, both in Indian press and global. But we were actually brought down to our knees in looking at how communities have really risen to the cause of the supporting each other in even non-notified slums of Mumbai, like Ambujwadi, Ambedkar Nagar. People, when we interviewed communities, said they're actually ashamed to stand in the queue to get food aid. And they've actually, within 2 months of the lockdown, set up their own food kitchens, got their rickshaw drivers who lost their daily wages to go door to door where the roads allowed it to supply the food from the community food kitchen to these small houses or huts. So it's amazing how much spirit there are in communities. And as you rightly said, Amit, dismantling the power and the ego syndrome to really looking at people as people, as you said, and collaborating with human beings with the instinct of survival without hate. And I think Zarina used a similar term starting to say you need to love the people you work with. So I think that really shone out in both of your narratives. I know we've been having a heavy discussion. So at the half hour point, I'm going to shift to the yin and yang. And I'm always fascinated with couples who work together harmoniously. I'm using harmoniously and smiling. I mean, you all should tell us the story. Both in the home front and, of course, for philanthropy in this discussion. And I know the pandemic has been even more stressful because, all of our support system, whether it is people who come and help us with the kitchen or cleaning at home, you know, those people who have been part of our family are no more able to be part of it because of the lockdown. So I know each of us have had different stresses in the last 4-5 months. So let me go over maybe first to Amit and Archana here, and maybe the respective, you know, the spouses have to close their ears so we can hear the true story and unvarnished story, so the audience can know how you all truly participate in your working at home and in your philanthropy. So over to you, Amit and Archana.
We thought of moving to Ronnie and Zarina's house across the road, which is much better stocked and with better domestic help.
Welcome.
You might have a long queue, Zarina, if you offer that in 500 people plus forum like Nudge.
We're okay to take with dabba service also. No, but I think, so Amit and I have been married for 26 years now, right? It was a bit of a child marriage for me, yes. And I think from the get-go, our whole equation or relationship, if you may, has been very, very participatory, right? In terms of anything and everything that we do. And often, we have not agreed on the same things. And I'll give you lots of examples. So for example, like Amit said, right, when we got married, we were living as paying guests. We had disposable income. We didn't have enough income to go around, right? And Amit would say, let's do the scholarship. And I was like, listen, can we just put, you know, a roof over our head? And then of course we'll do it. And then we come to some kind of a compromise. Okay, we won't give whatever, 100 rupees, can we give 50 or 60, etc. So I think we've done this push and pull between us from the beginning, right? And often we've come to land at a place which I'd like to believe is better because of the push and pull that it kind of encouraged in terms of the activity that we did, but also where our relationship has landed, right? So the same thing kind of extended to, you know, when there was more disposable income in terms of giving it away and how to be more thoughtful in the way we were giving it away. And I think over the years, God has been kind and Amit has done well. We've, you know, made, kind of formalized the giving through a foundation, right? And over here also, you know, the people who work with us will vouch for that. The conversations are not easy, right? Sometimes Amit is really excited about doing something and all guns are blazing and you can see he's a persuasive speaker. He's a very good speaker, right? And then I will have to gently sit up and say, but I think, and then, you know, so to give him his due, he's always been very, very open to a perspective or an opinion that's different from his own. And that has actually evolved into being a much more fun dinner table conversation. A child is often involved in them. And it's just, you know, it's kind of grown along with the relationship.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think, look, I think for us, pretty much everything we have done over the years has been a joint decision. We've been involved in building a lot of institutions, be it, you know, Ashoka, the Children's Hospital, you know, various schools. And I think there isn't one major decision that we have taken which has been completely unilateral or a place that Archana wouldn't have visited. But I think by and large, she's been more busy with Jai Vakil, while I've been more busy with all the stuff that we've been building via the giving portfolio. But I think as we've moved to a more structured approach via the foundation, I also personally felt the need for her to get more involved in a structured way, given the scale of what we do. And I think importantly, because as we started investing more and more in capacity building, I felt that that's an area where she could bring a lot of perspective, given she has grassroots experience in that as a NGO leader. And so, you know, she does bring, there is a yin and yang. I'm much more impulsive and I can tend to take decisions relatively quickly, and that does sometimes land to the wrong outcome. And I feel I value the fact that any car, fast car, I think can crash if it doesn't have an accelerator and a brake. And I think she can slow me down if I'm getting closer to making a mistake. And I think it's valuable to have that other perspective. I also think it's valuable because we have a very good, competent team, and I think team members have someone else who they can speak to, and they can have conversations with, not just me. And I think they find that valuable as well. We have a very open door policy in the foundation, and I think we've, as Archana says, we're very different people. We have no common taste in music, movies, food, pretty much other than our marriage, we have very little things in common. And but it's built to last, and we've had a great time building our philanthropic portfolio.
Thank you for being so candid. I think that was fascinating. I'm itching to ask more, but I think I have to have a team as the moderator. So I do want to hear Ronnie and Zarina's story as well, and I'm sure the audience is waiting.
Yeah, Zarina's good. Go ahead.
I don't know what to say. I mean, it's very similar, you know. It's. I feel like we're talking about us, except that we share, all our interests are exactly aligned. Okay, we love the same movies. We love music. We love the theater. We met in the theater, and actually, I think we met like in theater when I was still in college, right? We did theater while, so I've known Ronnie since then. Okay, we got married 20 years ago, but then we built this UTV together. And I think in 1986 or something, I just found a little card, which was an invitation of the first show I ever directed called The Mathemagic Show. At the Taj, you had a little launch party. I just found it. I was just digging through, doing some cleaning, spring cleaning. And I found that. So we've been together for a very long time. So I think what we want to do is in unity most of the time. Most of the time, the thing we want to do, okay, is in unity. But the how of it is totally different. You know, he has one way of working, I have another way of working. So we have these battle royals, you know. And as you said, I think sometimes our team, like they're listening to this. And in a meeting, they're arguing and like, no, and no, and yes, and no. But now I think after so many years and about 7 years of really active Swadesh, we've finally come to a way of working that we both agree on, okay? Which is exactly the same relationship. Rani wants to go really fast and I want to slow down and ask why, what, how, what, you know, and all that. So I tend to go slower, though I still think I'm pretty nimble, but you know, his speed is difficult to match, actually. But I think we do have, and I also want to add that we have a phenomenal team led by Mangesh Bange, who's our CEO, and a team of 300 people led by him. And working with this team also stabilizes us, you know, because they actually have the third point of view. So now we've reached a point where everybody in the room has a point of view, you know, at least when it comes to Swadesh. So it's a really healthy, dynamic atmosphere. I mean, it's a lot of fun to work and learn and grow and disagree. And usually I think we make so many mistakes that, you know, our meetings are always full of the mistakes, you know, and sometimes we forget to pat ourselves on the back and say, great work. So it takes someone like Preeta to say, oh, that's great. You know, because sometimes we feel that, you know, we're working so hard, we made so many mistakes, couldn't we have done it better? We're always talking like that. And I think both of us match there because we don't tend to be very congratulatory about the work we do. We think, oh God, we could have done it better. Oh God, we could have done it better. I think that we match on. But our methods are different, you know, the how of it.
Yeah, maybe I think there's enough said by all three of them. So I'll just do the topping on the icing as far as that is concerned. But I think when your goals are aligned, it makes a big difference. And I think when you start at a very early stage, as you know, Archana mentioned that they started with, you know, from a very, very early stage. So when your goals are aligned so early in life on things that you commonly want to do, I think it helps. It's frankly, the other part about couples and doing it, because when you're so close to each other, the element of competitiveness is not there. And I think there is no element of competitiveness or agenda. The agenda, when you're arguing, you know there's no agenda. When you have an argument without an agenda, where you know that the other person is not arguing for the sake of arguing, the argument can take a very productive turn, whereas otherwise you're half defending yourself. So there's never a conversation or an argument that we have where there is an element of competitiveness or somebody needs to win and somebody needs to lose. It's we need the best outcome at the end of it. And I think if you can manage to get the best outcome even after the end of arguments, that's important. And I just say at the end, as a summary, I mean, I think the empathy that Zarina brings with maybe the drive that I bring makes the yin and yang a little bit more complete, especially for a participative execution foundation.
Yeah, no, I can't agree more. I think, you know, Amartya Sen obviously spoke about the argumentative Indian, and at least I've sat in with Amit and Archana. So I know some things help to have some rich disagreements and then agree to agree or agree to disagree. So I think it is both of your philosophies are very rich, actually, to have a philanthropic approach that looks at it from different paradigms and actually balances that for the development goals. I've been trying to weave in the audience questions as much as possible. And I know we have the last 15 minutes slot. A big one now, if we can just zoom out a little, is looking back again at how working closely or participating with communities, other stakeholders, you think will really help India's overall development narrative, both, of course, to get out of this pandemic. I think we heard the end of the last session, because as we were logging in, Ingrid saying that, you know, if not coexistence, it's no existence. I mean, I just heard her finish with those remarks. And that is true, because we are way off SDG targets, and somebody will do the data crunching. But every single SDG goal that India already was at orange or red pre-pandemic is potentially at risk. So where do you see this kind of philanthropic approach zooming out or pulling up to India's overall development trajectory? Maybe Amit, Archana, do you all want to go first?
Sure. No, I think it's more of an imperative, because if you step back and think of it, Peeta, what's going to happen? Let's look at the two sides of the equation. Okay. You just articulated one side of the equation, which is, unfortunately, because of the pandemic, more people are, you know, hundreds of millions in the world, a large part of them in India, are going to be set back materially, right? If you look at the other side of the equation, which is the resources available to deal with it, and I, you know, as I was logging in, Amitabh Kant was framing his remarks, for the prior session, and he was making the point of how severely the global economy has been hit and what pressure that potentially causes, on government spending. But, we know what that pressure that causes on private spending, including philanthropy. So the second side of the equation is the resource pool available to address all these issues. We now have a very weird, situation, which is probably unprecedented in at least since independence and since, I've been looking at things where you're going to have a massive rise in need and a massive fall in ability to service that need. If we're going to have a real shot at solving this problem without having any sort of revolution, we will need a discontinuous approach. The old way of dealing with things is simply not going to work. And that will mean, we'll have to go back to the drawing board, and we'll have to think about, very, very different ways of solving problems. I personally feel participative philanthropy might well be one of those ways in which we'll have to do it. I mean, government's old ways of basically increasing the budget to address issues, it's not going to be an option anymore. I think you'll have to basically look at things. And I think that's where foundations like Swadesh and a lot of other people will basically have to curate interesting models that governments can look at and then dramatically scale, embed into their policies, and say, okay, I can actually solve the same problem with 30% less funding. And I think that will have to happen across livelihoods, education. I mean, I think we'll need very, very different ways of working.
Yeah, I mean, I think just to add there, I personally don't think we have a choice. We're a large nation and we've got all our problems are at scale. And to solve them, it's not just going to be financial resources. So what I very strongly feel is the sweat equity and the participation, especially from a younger. So if we have the youngest demographic in the world, we have to put that youngest demographic to work. Okay, and the only way they're going to be able to put themselves to work in this balanced approach is that they have to give back. They have to form this participative. Otherwise, we'll keep talking about the rural and urban divide. And now we found a new in the middle, right? Which is this whole migrant population, which is neither rural nor urban. And that's a large, large, large population there. So I think we don't have a choice. The participativeness in this, and I think one of the things for me is, you know, philanthropy is just a very heavy word. It's a word which just sounds so onerous to start with that the younger generation gets a little flipped with that. And I think we need to simplify that. We need to break it down because actually giving back in many ways can happen at various levels. The most important thing, as I say, is sweat equity because that participativeness, and that's where you're seeing that. The reason we have a ranking of 0.2% of our GDP goes to charity or giving back versus the US where it's 2%, outside of the fact that 1.8 of that 2% goes to university grants and all, which may or may not deserve it. And that's a different discussion and a religious thing, which I think, well, you know, there's a big talk. I mean, you can go on and on about whether they even deserve that. So whether it's going to be called in the social sector, where actually they reinvest in the market and have endowment funds, is really that the sweat equity calculation in India is not put there. And I think we would be at 2% of GDP if we added our sweat equity. So it is an absolute imperative. It is something that we need to do. And we need to garner a 1:1 ratio, literally, where if you can do that, that will make an entire big difference, the participative part of it, without it being so onerous that you need to have something or it has to be always financial. We've got enough natural resources. You know, the rural part in their entire environment can solve a lot without just the cutting of the check and the financial resources. We just need them to increase their aspiration levels. We need them to understand financial inclusion. We need to give them solutions of how they can create larger, better income, work in a more collaborative ways, spur up entrepreneurship in rural India versus us always kind of, you know, putting a halo around startup India with a few people who raise $100 million. That's not the real India. The real India is where the entrepreneurship can happen at the grassroots level.
Yeah. And just on that point, Ronnie, look, talking about grassroots and, you know, the real India, you know, there is a big role that technology is playing in general, but more so now, you know, given the pandemic. And I know through UpGrad, your work in EdTech, and there's so much talk about both the potential, but also the constraints to using technology, right? Like a lot of India is not as connected, both in terms of their internet connectivity or devices, or even just technology literacy. So, you know, how do you really think about, if I might borrow the word of uberization of technology for India's development? I mean, do you see this as a very long-term dream or, you know, do you have some tips and tricks from your work in EdTech?
See, from where I come, both in EdTech and in media, I think the consumer leads the way. We always make it sound like technology leads the way. The technology sometimes does it, but most of the times the consumer change then leads the way. And I think we're over-dramatizing the fact that, yes, we do have certain connectivity issues, but they're getting resolved. Even in our present geography, at Swadesh, for example, we find that 45% of the people have a 4G connection. They do have smartphones. So for us to start up of what we call our Digital Swadesh initiative is a very strong movement for us to be able to do that. And being able to first do advocacy, then do actual training, and then actually do two-way of everything else. And if you start with the 50 people, the balance of the 50 people will follow. So I'm someone, as a first-generation entrepreneur, always looks at the cup that is half full, and then how to build on that. And I think those problems will get solved. Like, you know, we solved and we became the lowest ARPU country in terms of telecom, some for good reason, some for bad reason, but actually to the benefit of the consumer at the end of the day. Otherwise, you wouldn't have had this entire thought. So while we say, you know, education may be the rift between urban and rural, but you actually have access to information now that is actually dropping the urban and rural divide also.
Yep, no, that is true. Putting consumers first and using technology to enable that change, I think, is key.
Specifically for countries like India, yes, so.
Yeah. And also the young people, Preeta, really just love technology, whether they're rural or urban. I think Archana will bear me out. I mean, will agree with me. I mean, what beautiful work she's done so fast. How are those people accessing? Half the time it's the kids, and I'm talking about kids who are 5 years old. I'm not even talking about 17-year-old kids. I'm talking about 5-year-old kids who are addicted to mobile in villages today. I mean, it's insane. So the potential is there. I was just thinking of one word, Preeta, that what I think is missing and what really needs to develop, I mean, you can call it ecosystem, but that's a big word, are connections. Mm. We need to connect people. We need to connect all kinds of people. We need to connect urban schools with rural schools. We need to connect urban entrepreneurs with rural entrepreneurs. We need to connect market linkages. We need to connect teaching institutions of various kinds. I mean, I was just thinking, oh, I want those 200 videos of Archana's, definitely, for Swadesh. I mean, just connect, build the connections. And I think digital is a phenomenal way to build connections in the app. And there's nothing like human contact. Human contact is essential. But in times of COVID and in other future times, if it's not possible, it's a great way to test a digital model for all of us. And we all are all doing it. And I think it's a fantastic exercise to build this ecosystem that can work in times of crisis, you know?
Absolutely.
I wanted to add one thing to what Zarina's point, as well as the one Ronnie made earlier. I think we in our heads sometimes identify problems that need to be solved for upfront, right? Like this whole digital divide. So we have the same thing, right? How is my child, in Latur going to be able to access this video, right? And I think the biggest thing that we need to solve for, or the first thing that we actually need to solve for, is a mindset change, right? Whether it is in the younger generation or even in ours. So I'll give you an example with this mindset change, right? So yes, to all the things that Rani, Zarina, and Amit have said, but we have found that often we underestimate issues, right? Or we don't even understand issues. So when I'm talking about mindset, let me give you an example. And this is also to your earlier question on, you know, what does India need to do as a whole? So I think when, like Amit was saying in one of his definitions of philanthropic partnership philanthropy, the idea is to also identify the root cause. So in a space like intellectual disability, 2% of our population has IDD, but you don't see these children or people in malls and theaters in any of these public places that we go to. So the first step there that you need to do is just do a mindset change where people who have family members talk about them, bring them out in the open, and society as a whole therefore sees them, understands them, accepts them, and then only can inclusion happen. So, you know, whether it is the digital divide, whether it is any of the interventions that we're doing, I think the first thing is to solve for it at a mindset level.
Absolutely.
And totally
I think
agree.
Just a couple of minutes to go. So I'm going to literally do a quick round robin of no more than two words by each of you. But a lot of questions come in about what's your advice to future budding philanthropists or youth who may not just want to give money, like all of you said, but give their sweat equity. Just two words. And any of you can go first on the hot seat.
I'm just going to say, just do it. What are you waiting for?
Yeah,
get on with it.
It comes down to it. It's dive into it. Absolutely dive into it. Don't overthink that. And start small. Start small,
start
get
small.
The reward, start big. And then you can grow.
Also, start small and start with those around you. Start close by.
Yep.
And look for the impact. Look for the impact. As you get impact, you'll get more positive energy. That energy will get you to create more impact. It's a very
That's
strong.
Awesome, in a nutshell, Archana, Amit, two, three words.
I think what I say to anybody and everybody is find a place, a cause, or people that make your heart sing. Everything else will come.
Yep.
Yeah.
I would say two things. I completely agree with Ronnie and Serena. In fact, start early is what I tell everybody. People get into analysis paralysis. Start early is definitely. Second is people think this is about changing the world. It's about changing yourself.
Ah, perfect. Great. Bravo.
So I think that's put very well.
So I love it.
Thank you everyone for being so engaged. Thank you to my panelists. You all were very engaged. From 360 degrees development to root cause to empathy evidence to building bridges. I think we had a lot of interesting insights, and I'm sure your inboxes are going to come in with more questions. So over to Sriram. Thanks to everyone again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. It was lovely being with you.
Thanks, Archana. Thanks, Archana.
Thank you.